बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम। टुडेज टॉपिक इज सैम्पलिंग एंड सिग्नल कोरिलेशन। द कोर्स टाइटल इज प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ कम्युनिकेशन सिस्टम्स। आई एम डॉक्टर जिशान कलीम फ्रॉम ईसी डिपार्टमेंट सीयूआई युवा कैंपस। ओके, लेट्स मूव टुवर्ड द लेक्चर कंटेंट्स। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी विल कवर व्हाट इज सैम्पलिंग एंड सेकेंडली वी विल डिस्कस सिग्नल कोरिलेशन। Sampling property of the unit impulse function. Why this is much important in communication system? The sampling, because whenever you convert the signal from analog to digital, for example, this is your analog signal and you like to convert into a digital signal like this signal, right? So there is a step from analog to digital conversion. First step is the sampling. So how can we perform the sampling? This is another topic, but mathematically we can describe the sampling here as a unit impulse function. So from equation it follows that if you can see that this is our function, for example phi t, we can call this one as a phi t, right? This one as a phi t, and this is impulse. Everyone of you know that what is impulse. The impulse is a function, for example this one, which has only amplitude of 1 at time 0, right? So this is called an impulse. It has amplitude 1 at time equals to 0. So it means that if we put time equals to 0, if you, for example, this is our function phi t and this is the equals to time 0, for example this is time 0. So if we multiply it with impulse like this one, which has a amplitude of 1 at time 0, so what we will get in result? We will get the same signal, like the amplitude of the signal at time 0. Look at this, phi at 0 into delta impulse of t at 0, which is equal to 1. So 1 into phi 0, what will you get? Phi 0 means the amplitude of the signal, or the what would be the value of the signal at time instant 0, you will get in the output. So provided phi t is a continuous at time 0, this result means that area under the product of a function with an impulse delta t is equal to the value of that function at the instant where the unit impulse is located, as I mentioned. So this property is very important and useful and known as the sampling property or the shifting property of the unit impulse. So it's another way, another example, for example this one was at the time 0. So if you take impulse at time equals to t, right, t equals to capital T, then what would be the value of the phi t at t we will get in the output. So phi impulse t minus t, it will be equal to 1 at time t equals to t. So put capital T here, so we will get phi capital T. So it means that we will get the amplitude of the signal or area of the signal at that instant. So equation is just another form of a sampling of shifting property. In this case, the impulse, which is equal to 1, is located at time t equals to t rather than t equals to 0. Therefore, the area under phi t into delta t minus t is phi capital T, right? Phi, and this can be easily clear to you. For example, if you multiply anything or any signal with 1, so then in the end you will get the output which with the value of the signal, because 1 will not affect the output, right? So the value of phi t at the instant where the impulse is located. In these derivations, we have assumed the function is continuous at the instant where the impulse is located. So this is the sampling property of the unit impulse. So we can use that sampling property to get samples, and in the end, it will be used to convert analog to digital signal. The other is unit step function. Why is it important? Because unit step, first of all, you have to know that what is unit step, then we can discuss the importance of the unit step. Firstly, the unit step function is always the amplitude of the unit step function is 1 when the time is greater than or equal to 0. So this was how it looks like. For example, this is time axis. So it will be 1 when t is equal to 0, and it will be 0 when t is less than 0. So this is 0. When t greater than or equal to 0, it results in 1, otherwise it's 0. If we want to want a signal to start at t equals to 0, so that it has a value of 0 for t less than 0, we only need to multiply the signal with ut. So what is the importance of the ut is that whenever you have a signal, for example, you have a signal something like this, right? This one. Now you just want the signal start from here. So what you will do? You will just multiply the signal. For example, this is e minus at, for example. Then you multiply it with ut, right? Ut u of t. Example, multiply with ut. So what will you get? This part will be cancelled out and you will get the signal from here, right? So in this way you can make it as a causal signal. Why? Because a signal that does not start before t is equal to 0 is called a causal signal. In other words, gt is a causal signal if gt equals to 0 for less than 0. So it means that if the signal starts from the time 0, then it is causal. So to make any signal causal, we just multiply that signal with unit step, it will make a causal signal. This is an example, as I already discussed. This is a unit step function with amplitude 1 for t is equal to 0. So when we multiply e minus at with ut, so there is a no part of the signal before time equals to 0. So it makes it in a causal signal. The other thing is that if we combine the impulse functions, like from minus infinity to t, so it will give you 0 for t less than 0, and for t greater or equal to 0, it will give 1. So it means that, for example, you know that when t equals to 0, impulse is 1, right? When, for example, when we called it t equals to 1, impulse is also 1, right? This is discrete, but if you take a continuous one, so for every point there will be an impulse, for every point there will be an impulse, right? If we are taking time period like minus infinity to t, for example, so in this way if we combine, then it will become a signal like a unit impulse, unit step function, not unit impulse. So when we combine different impulses, it can become a unit step as well. So this was just a concept about the unit step function. Okay, let's discuss correlation of signals. It is clearly seen or understand, we can clearly understand from the name that correlation means a similarity. So similarity measures of a two signals or a two vectors based on its length only is not the proper way of measuring the correlation among the signals. For example, if you have a two vectors, this and this, if you say that just we measure the length of these two vectors, if they are same, we can't call that these two vectors are always similar. So similarly, among the two vectors is similarity among the two vectors is measured by the angle, which we call theta, between the two vectors or the signals. So smaller the theta among the signal, larger is the similarity. But it means that if this is one vector and this is another vector, right? So if the angle between them is similar or less, we can call the similar or less, then they are similar. For example, the angle is theta is 0 degree, so they overlap each other. But if we call theta is 45 degree, for example, theta is equal to 45 degree, then this will look like something in this way, right? This 45, for example, this one 45 degree. So their similarity reduces. So thus the amount of similarity can be exactly measured in terms of a cos theta. So we can use a cos theta as a metric to measure the similarity among the two signals. So larger the cos theta, larger is the similarity between the two vectors. What does it mean? For example, cos of 0, cos of 0 degree. What is cos of 0 degree? It's 1, right? So it means that it has the larger value, right? 1. What about the cos of 90? Cos of 90 degree is 0. So its value is less. So it means that similarity is less, right? So larger the cos theta, larger is the similarity between the vectors. Thus, the suitable measure of the correlation is cos of theta. So we can call that cos of theta into dot product of g of x. G and x are two different vectors, and then their amplitude, g amplitude, x amplitude. So we can readily verify that this measure is independent of the length of g and x. So from here we can notice that because we are just focusing on the angle rather than the length of the vectors. So this similarity measure is independent of the length of g and x. So this similarity measure is known as correlation coefficient. So correlation coefficient lies between minus 1 to 1 maximum. So minus 1 is the minimum case when the vectors are opposite. For example, cos of 180 degree, you know that cos of 180 degree is minus 1, right? Is equal to minus 1. So this means that when angle is when rho or the cos of theta or the similarity measure is minus 1, it means that they are not similar, they are in opposite direction as well. And when rho equals to 1, so it means that they are similar and they have a maximum correlation, right? Okay, in the previous slide we discussed about the two vectors. Now if we want to, because we are dealing here with the signals, so what correlation, how the correlation factor can be calculated for the case of the two signals, for example gt and xt. So thus the magnitude of rho is never greater than unity if two vectors are aligned, as we discussed earlier, because the similarity theta is 0, so rho is equal to 1. Two vectors are aligned in opposite direction have the maximum dissimilarity, as we discussed, cos theta, cos 180 degree is minus 1, so rho is equal to minus 1 in that case. If two vectors are orthogonal, the similarity is 0. Orthogonal means they are 90 degree out of phase. So in this case, similarity is 0. So we use that argument, the similar argument which we discussed about the vectors. Now we are using the same argument for defining the correlation or the similarity index for the signal. Previously we discussed general for the vector. Now signals are treated as a vector as well in communication. So for convenience, we shall consider the signals over the entire time interval from minus infinity to infinity. So to establish a similarity index independent of energies, because we need to normalize them to make it independent of the signal energies or sizes of gt and xt. As I told you in the start of the these chapters, that energy or the power or the matrix to calculate the size of the signal in signal and system. So to make it independent of the energies, it means to make it independent of the size of the gt and gt, xt, we must normalize C by normalizing the two signals to have a unit energy. So these are the two signals, gt, xt. So to normalize them, we will divide with their energies, eg and ex under root. Why under root? Because this is the unit here is, for example, only volt, for example. So make it the similar unit, we will take the under root, right? So thus the appropriate similarity index analogous to equation, previous equation is given by. So for the case of the signals, we will always use this equation to calculate the similarity between the two signals. So what is this? 1 over under root eg ex and minus infinity to plus infinity in general. So GT, XT are the two signals. So similarly, here we mentioned that rho is equal to 1, k is any positive constant. So rho is equal to minus 1 when k is any negative constant, when rho is equal to 0 if GT and XT are orthogonal. Thus, the maximum similarity is indicated by rho is equal to 1. Dissimilarity, rho is equal to minus 1. Orthogonality, when rho is equal to 0. So quantitatively, qualitatively speaking, we may view orthogonal signals as unrelated signals, right? Note that the maximum dissimilarity is different from unrelatedness qualitatively, right? So we generalize the rho to include the complex signals, right? For the complex signal and the real signal. So in case of the complex signal, we have x conjugate t here. So this is the only difference of the equation for the conjugate and the real signal. Thank you for listening. For question answer session, there will be a separate online session. So exact date and time will be communicated later on. Thank you very much.